He will satisfy. Taste of His goodness, find what you're looking for. God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live
said it'd be cool.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to the Sunday night service of revival. We're just so thrilled to death for you to be here tonight. So thrilled that we have the privilege to be in the waters of baptism. Oh, what a joy. You say, well, why is baptism so important? Does baptism save you? No, baptism doesn't save you. It is very symbolic. Baptism is an outward symbol of something's already taken place in the heart.
That's right. That's right.
And the work that the Lord Jesus Christ does when He forgives a person of their sins and imputes righteousness to them, that's salvation. And He calls on us to obey Him and follow through with baptism, and then pray, and then witness, and then disciple, so forth and so on. And we're just glad to be a part of that tonight, and so thankful for our candidates tonight. Our first candidate is Whitney Blevins. Whitney, would you come on down? Whitney, is it true that you've asked the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive you of all your personal sins that come into your heart and save your soul?
Yes.
Whitney, based upon that profession of faith, I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death. And raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. Next candidate's Jonathan Blevins. Jonathan, you come on down. Come on down, my brother. Amen. Jonathan, is it true that you've asked the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive you of all your sins, to come into your heart and save your soul?
Yes.
Jonathan, based upon that profession of faith, I now baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death and raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah, praise God. Praise God. Amen. Brother Rock's going to preach when it's time to preach. Let's keep worshiping.
Thank you.
Good evening, church. If you would please stand. If you would like to use your hymnal, our first hymn will be on page 29. This half of the congregation will sing with Grace and myself, and then the other half will be the echo. $5.99, soon and very soon. Page 305, Amazing Love.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your Spirit within me, because you died and rose.
Sweet time of worship we've already enjoyed. It's so good to see you. I just couldn't wait to get back tonight. Could y'all? Amen. About a half dozen. Amen. If you have your Bible, turn with me to the Gospel of John. John chapter 4. While you're turning, let me say thank you again for the privilege of being here. Pastor Tommy, thank you for the invitation to come. I love your pastor. We had some good fellowship today, and It's been a while since I've got to visit with him, and we just kind of picked up where we left off. That's what brothers do. And I am so grateful for you, Pastor. And you have a pastor that loves you. But he loves his wife more than he loves you. And he should. And he loves the Lord more than he loves his wife. You're a blessed church to have such a pastor. I encourage you to pray for him every chance you get. Just lift him up for the Lord and say, God, just speak to him and speak through him so I can get what you want me to get. Amen. If he makes you mad, just pray for him that much more. Amen. John chapter 4. I'm going to begin to read in just a moment in verse 5. But before I begin to read, I want to talk for just a little bit tonight about when Jesus shows up. Have you noticed that he'll just show up? Have y'all noticed that about Jesus? He'll just show up. Sometimes you're looking for him, sometimes you aren't. He'll just show up. Unexpectedly, sometimes he just shows up. I remember reading how the disciples were up in an upper room and Jesus had been crucified and buried and rose from the dead, and they were sitting up there wondering what to do, and Jesus just showed up. Nobody invited him. Nobody opened the door. Nobody opened the window. He was just in their midst. I'm glad to have a Lord such as that who can just show up. I'm praying he's going to just show up tonight. Matter of fact, I believe he's already here. I wasn't going to depend on anybody else. I went ahead and invited him myself, so I know he's here. Amen. So I want to show you in the text when Jesus showed up. John chapter 4, I'm going to begin to read in verse 5. And I'm going to ask you if you would, in reverence to the Word of God, stand with me as we read. John chapter 4, beginning in verse 5. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. And there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. And Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your word. Lord, it is indeed our bread of life. Lord, you feed us and nourish us so well with your word, and I just say thank you tonight. And God, I pray that it would please you to preach your word to us tonight. May you just dismiss me and set me to the side and let us hear from heaven. God, I pray you would preach to us, stir our hearts and move us as only you can. God, my heart is so full already, rejoicing over the testimonies of those who have followed you through the watery grave. God, I thank you that you're still saving souls. God, I pray tonight it'd please you to preach. And Lord, would it just please you to preach to the end that somebody might get saved this evening. Lord, if there's one lost, draw them to yourself. And Lord, for those who know you, I pray you'd work in our hearts as only you can. And Lord, I want to be sure that all the praise and the honor and the glory is credited to Jesus. And it's in his name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Jesus is journeying, and he went down to Samaria. There was a well there called Jacob's Well, and he sat down on it, and here comes a woman to draw water. Now, I'm imagining, though the text doesn't say, I'm imagining that she had been to the well before. It just seems apparent. She's showing up at the well because that's where she gets water, because they didn't have any running water at the house, so she had to carry a pot down there and get water on a regular basis. So she knew where she was going. She shows up there, and when she gets there, lo and behold, there's a man sitting on the well there. Now, it just appears to me that from her point of view, she'd have to say he just showed up. Because I don't find anywhere she was looking for him. But there he was. And when he gets there, He's seated and waiting, and she comes with a pot, and he said, give me something to drink. Boy, when Jesus shows up, there's some things that happen when Jesus shows up. Can I show them to you? All right. Amen. Thank you for agreeing. Amen. Number one, when Jesus shows up, there's going to be some questions. I said, there's going to be some questions. This woman's going to jump right in, and she's going to begin to ask questions. See, it says in verse 8, for his disciples were going away unto the city to buy meat. See, those were Baptists, and they knew he was hungry. They went down to Chick-fil-A, and they're going to bring back some Baptist bird, amen? And so, they're not with him. He's by himself. He's just showed up from her perspective. Verse 9, then saith the woman of Samaria to him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Now, I want to get to this question because there's more than just one question. But when Jesus shows up, it's going to raise some questions. And before I approach her question, I just want to tell you something. I want you to hear me real clear. Jesus is not intimidated by questions. He can handle your question. When I was a freshman at Carson Newman, the Lord called my dad home. He was preaching revival that week, and on Friday, God called him home, 44 years old. Preaching a revival, preached all week, and God just took him like that. Didn't know until 3 weeks later in autopsy he had a malignant brain tumor, and that's what caused him to leave this world. Now, can I tell y'all something? I had answered the call to preach less than a year before my dad went to heaven. My daddy was not just my daddy, he was my pastor. So God had called me to preach, and I was so glad I had such a mentor so close. I was living with him. Amen. And now, less than a year later, God takes him. I want you to hear me and hear me real clear. Not for one second did I or have I questioned God's deity. God is God. I am not. But I'd heard all my life, and especially at this time, I heard people say, we ought never ask God why. And I believe we shouldn't question his deity. But I came to understand he was a big enough God to handle my why. God, I'm not asking you, based on you being God, why all this has come about. That's your business. Your God, I'm not. But I am wondering why. And you know what I found? God just kicked me to the curb. No, he didn't. He loved me. And I said, Lord, I don't understand why. And God, I need him. And God said, if you had needed him, I would have left him. I want you to learn to trust me as your daddy. I'm just testifying that God is not intimidated by your questions. Why do I say that? I want to remind you, it's okay to talk with the Lord. It's okay to share your heart with the Lord. It's okay to say, Lord, I don't understand why. Can you help? Because you hadn't scared him. I said, you hadn't scared him. So here's this woman marching down here, and she sees this man who apparently has just showed up, and she said, hey, I need to ask you a question. Would you notice when Jesus shows up that the questions that come will often be cultural in nature? She said, how is it that you, being a Jew and a man, are talking to me, a Samaritan and a woman? Because you see, the Jews didn't think much of the Samaritans. They looked down on them. And they didn't think much of them as a race of people. And so there were no dealings between the Jews and the Samaritans. And furthermore, in that day, the culture was not only not acceptable of those two talking, but he was a man and she was a woman. And beyond that, he was a teacher and she was a woman. And they should never speak in public. That was the culture. That's the culture that they were living in. You know what I found? When Jesus shows up today, we're still getting a lot of cultural questions. Because our culture seems to be setting the agenda for the society. Hello? Why do y'all hold to these things? Why do you say somebody shouldn't do this or they shouldn't do? Why do you think it's important to go down there and go to church? Our culture has been set by a godless society who questions us about why we do what we do when it comes to Jesus. I just wanted to stop by tonight and tell you, culture doesn't set the agenda for the Lord Jesus Christ. Culture doesn't determine right and wrong. God did all that all by himself. And he wrote it in a book. Our culture says, you bunch of crazy Christian, y'all just read that old archaic book. Amen, we sure do. You know why? Because that old archaic book is still relevant today. Do you know why? Because this word is God's word, and God's word is living. This is as relevant in John chapter 4 when Jesus sat on the side of Jacob's well and this woman came, it's just as relevant today as it was that day, because his word never changes, yet it remains alive. So when Jesus shows up today, our culture's got a lot of questions. You bunch of Christians, you read an archaic book. And you bunch of Christians have a bloody religion. You always talk about the blood. And you talk about Jesus shedding his blood. And you sing songs about the blood. You people are crazy. Well, bless the Lord, I don't want a religion to begin with. But I don't want a faith that doesn't include the blood, whereby is the only way my sins could be forgiven. Yes, we believe in the blood of Jesus. And no, we don't apologize for believing it. There are going to be some cultural questions that arise, and I just want to help you. It doesn't matter what the culture has to say. What does God's word say? Because one of these sweet days when I stand before the Lord, he's not going to judge me based on the culture. He's going to judge me based on his word. There are going to be some cultural questions. So I just want to remind you that our God is greater than our culture. Amen. But not only will there be some cultural questions when Jesus shows up, but don't you notice there's going to be some real practical questions. Let me tell you how Jesus answered there in verse 10. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou would have asked of him and he would have given thee living water. Let me show you something about Jesus' response. She asked a cultural question. It's a good question. I said, it's a good question. It's fine. From where she's coming from, she needs to ask a question. And she's right here in this conversation, and Jesus is right here. He said, give me something to drink. She said, how is it you being a Jewish man asking me, a Samaritan woman? And Jesus said, if you'd have asked me, I'd have given you water to drink. You water like you've never had before. And the woman asked a real practical question. Look at this. Sir, verse 11, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well, it's deep. From whence then hast thou the living water? Listen, folks, I don't know about you, but that's a great question. She says, now, sir, you're talking about some living water, but this well right here, I've been here a lot, and it's deep, and you don't even have a pot. You don't have a cup. You don't have a bowl. You don't have a thimble. You have absolutely nothing. That is a good question, isn't it? I mean, here sits a guy wanting something to drink, but he don't have anything to drink out of. Amen? And so she says, how is it you talking about drinking living water, but you can't even draw out of the well? Does anybody else find it interesting that the woman is saying to the man what put the water in the well to begin with? He knew to the very milliliter how much water was in there. He knew exactly how deep it was because he made it to start with. Man, that's good, isn't it? You know what? Sometimes our practical questions overlook who he is. How are you going to get some of this water? You don't even have a cup. And here she is wondering such a thing, and she doesn't even know who it is that she's talking to. And so she moves from a cultural question and a practical question. Now she's going to ask a religious question. Look at this in verse 12. Art thou greater than our father Jacob? I'm telling you, this is just like our world. This is just like our world. Jesus has just showed up, and she's already on her third question of a different category. Cultural question, practical question, and now a religious question. Are you greater than Jacob? Don't you love that? Isn't that just like our world? Because at some point when they figure out you're talking about things they don't know, understand, they can't talk about, you're up here and they're down here, and you're trying to have this spiritual conversation and they're not there, then they start and figure out you're going to talk about some spiritual things, and so they want to present themselves and all of their religiosity. Are you greater than Jacob? See, she knew who Jacob was. Hello? She knew something about some religion in her life. She knew something about how it was to worship and to study and to know. But it was just empty religion. Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Look at her. She's not just saying, are you greater than Jacob? But she is telling him all she knows about religious matters. Are you greater than Jacob? Why, you know, he gave us this well, and his children, why, they even drunk from this well. See, she knew her history, and she knew her religion. And so it caused her to question Jesus about just who he is. Are you greater than Jacob? Ladies and gentlemen, today, when you start talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, we live in a society that wants to ask, is he greater than? And just pick something. Because they love to ask these questions. Well, I don't know about Jesus. I prayed one time and he didn't help me. He didn't hear your prayer, honey. You're not saved. First prayer he wanted to hear from you is, Lord, save me. Amen? Religion is not what our Lord's interested in. She wanted to show how much she knew, but in so doing, she was showing how much she didn't know. I remember having a young man come to our church a number of years ago, and one of my faithful witnesses in the church, man, he was all the time bringing folk to church. You just never know who he's going to drag into church, because he'd been out witnessing to them, and he'd win them to Jesus and they'd come, or he'd try to win them and they didn't get saved, he'd bring them to church. Man, I just loved that guy. And he brought this fella in one night, one Sunday morning, actually. He brought him to meet me. He said, I want you to meet my preacher. And man, he brought him back there, and I'm telling you what, he was a rough-looking dude. Let me see if I can say it again. He was a rough-looking dude. And I wasn't sure what was about to happen because he was a rough-looking dude. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? I'm not going to go into explanation. I'm just telling you, he was a rough-looking dude, kind of scary-like. And so I just back there, and I thought, well, I'm just going to be my normal, nice self. Hey, man, how you doing? So nice to meet you. Glad you came. And, you know, and then the Lord just got in my mind. Said, won't you talk to him about me? I said, Lord, he's a rough-looking dude. He said, yeah, talk to him about me. And I said, sir, I just need to ask you, have you ever asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart and be Lord of your life? And he looked right dead in my eye, and he said, sir, I'm not into religion. And I looked dead into his eye and said, sir, neither am I. I said, as a matter of fact, the Lord I serve is not into religion either. but he's big into relationship, and he wants a relationship with you. He loved you so much that he died on the cross and shed his blood for your sin. 3 days later, he rose from the dead victorious, and he wants a relationship with you. 2 weeks later, he got saved. Praise be to God. Rough looking dude, but King Jesus showed up because Jesus was not interested in religion, but he was interested in relationship. This woman wants to show how much religion and knowledge and history she knows, but in the process, it only revealed who she didn't know. Don't get mad when you're witnessing to somebody and in this lost world they start telling you how much they know about religion. Just smile and listen. And then tell them about Jesus. When Jesus shows up, there are going to be some cultural questions. There's going to be some practical questions. There's going to be some religious questions. But ultimately, when Jesus shows up, the desire of one's heart's going to come to the top. It's going to be revealed. So look at this. Jesus answered and said unto her, "Whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst again. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." Man, I'm telling you what now. Have y'all been watching this conversation? Jesus is up here on a spiritual level. She's not quite there. They're trying to get there. And I am hopeful in this very next verse. Watch this. It said, "The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water." Praise God. I think we're about to get there. She's wanting some of this water. Okay? He's up here on this spiritual plane. She's not there. But he's trying to bring her up. And now she says, "I want some of that water." See, he said, "I can give you water that you'll never thirst again. I'll give you water that'll satisfy your soul." And she's like, "I want some of that." But there's a comma. "Sir, give me this water that I thirst not." So we understand she's thirsty. But there's another comma. "Neither come hither to draw." The reality was, yes, she wanted water to quench her thirst. But she is tired of coming down there getting water out of the well. I'm just reading what the text says. See, Jesus is up here on a spiritual plane and she's not there. "I can give you water you'll never thirst again." She said, "I want some of that because I don't want to have to come down here to the well." Could I tell you something I noticed in this text? This woman came by herself to the well. You go back and read it there in verse 7. She came by herself to the well. Do you know traditionally women would go to the well in at least pairs? I don't know why. I'm just saying traditionally that's the way they did. But she was coming by herself. Maybe she didn't have any close friends. Maybe she didn't have any neighbors that wanted to walk down there with her. Maybe people didn't think much of her. I don't know why she was by herself. I just know she was by herself. And it makes sense to me when Jesus said, "I can give you water to drink. You'll never thirst again. And therefore, you wouldn't have to come to the well." I understand where she's coming from. She's saying, "I don't want to have to keep coming down here. And I especially don't like coming by myself. I like to be around people. And nobody wants to walk down here with me." I don't know how many times she had to go to the well. I don't know how many times a day she had to go down there and fill up the water pot. I don't know how much water she used at her house. All I know is at this particular time she was by herself and the desire of her heart was to quit coming to the well. When Jesus shows up, the reality and the desire of your heart will begin to rise to the top. And here's Jesus who has showed up, and do you know what she says in essence? "I am dissatisfied with the status quo in my life. I'm tired of coming down here every day by myself to draw water. I don't want to have to do it anymore. I want to be satisfied of my thirst. I'm tired of the status quo." Hey, when Jesus shows up, he'll give you a little taste of something that'll make you say, "I'm tired of the status quo. I'm tired of just getting by. I'm tired of just getting through. I'm tired of just doing what we've always done, keep getting what I always got. I'm tired of that. I want something else." And that's what's happening in her life, because Jesus is talking up here and she's trying to figure out what in the world this man's talking about. All she knows is, I'm tired of coming down here to draw water, so this water deal sounds pretty good. Ladies and gentlemen, when Jesus shows up, there's going to be some questions. There'll be cultural questions, practical questions, religious questions, and ultimately the desire of the heart will come to the top. But let me show you something else. When Jesus shows up, not only will questions be asked, but when Jesus shows up, baggage gets unpacked. I said baggage gets unpacked. Look at this next this verse. This is something. Jesus said unto her, go call your husband and come back. And the woman said, I have no husband. And Jesus said, you got that right. That's not exactly the interpretation of the text, but somewhere in that neighborhood. Go get your husband. I don't have one. You're right. You've had five. And you're shacked up. I forgot where I am. You're cohabitating with someone outside of marriage. Y'all know what it means to be shacked up, don't you? And that's what Jesus basically said. You've been married five times, and you shacked up with the one you're with now. You're not married to him. You're living out of wedlock. You're living in sin. Hey, when Jesus shows up, he'll unpack your baggage. Can I tell you something about baggage? We all got some. I said we all got. Don't look at me like you didn't walk in here with baggage. Every one of us got some baggage. Everybody here has some baggage. You got some stuff that you would rather not everybody know. I'm sure that's where she was. That's why when he said, go get your husband, she didn't respond by saying which one. She just assumed he not know. Go get your husband. Well, that might be difficult. No, she just went for the blanket. Don't have one. But the problem is, when Jesus shows up, he already knows about your baggage. It's amazing to me that we think we can hide something from God. Well, there's some stuff in my life nobody knows about. God knows about it. Well, my husband or wife don't know. My children don't know. My parents don't know. My coach don't know. My coworkers don't know. My preacher don't know. The deacons don't know. The folk at church don't know. But God knows. Every one of us have baggage. Every one of us have some baggage that is something we don't want to talk about. I don't know if you've heard me yet. Let me say it again. Everybody here has baggage. Who do you think you are looking down your long hypocritical nose at somebody else and thinking how bad they are? I'm not like them. Well, I didn't do what they did. No, but he knows what you did do. Well, I never had no five husbands and shacked up with a man. Good, what have you done? Ladies and gentlemen, when I have read this passage, God has convicted my heart so bad that this woman is a beautiful picture of us. And when Jesus shows up, he knows your heart. He knows everything in your life that you've ever done. He knows every mistake you've made. He knows every broken relationship that you've ever had. He knows every sin you've committed. He knows every thought that you've ever had. He knows absolutely everything about you, and there's nobody here who doesn't have a suitcase full. We all have some baggage. And when you look at somebody and say, well, I just don't know about them, I'm not going to talk to them about Jesus. Why? Well, you know, I'm a little better than that. We'd never say that. We Baptists, we don't say that out loud. I'm better than somebody. But you think it. We all have had broken hearts, broken lives, broken promises, broken relationships, broken attempts to do what's right and to do what is good and seemly in the eyes of God. We've all come short. There is none without sin. No, not one. I'm not a bit better than anybody else. And I'll talk to people about Jesus. I love talk to lost people. And well, I'm as good as you, preacher. You know what I like to say to that? Good, that'll get you to hell. I'm not the standard. Neither are you. How dare we look at somebody else and think their baggage is worse than ours? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm concerned that we're not sharing the love of Jesus with the lost world because we think some people are so much worse than we are, and we think we wouldn't say it out loud. God forbid we'd never say it out loud, but you know what they're doing? They deserve to go to hell. And the truth is, every one of us sitting here deserve to go to hell. We deserve to already be in hell, not to go to hell. We deserve to already be there. We deserve to be eternally separated from King Jesus because of our sin, because of where we failed. And the Bible said the wages of sin is death. We all deserve death. We're not better than anybody else. We all carry baggage. God forbid we think our baggage smells less in the sight of God than other people's baggage. God help us. You can hide nothing from God. Oh, we want Jesus to just show up. Do you really? Because when he does, he's going to convict you of your sin. Let me tell you what I'm hearing about revival up at Asbury in Kentucky. And I'm hearing other places that God is moving. You know what's happening? Well, they've got these great preachers. No. They got these wonderful music. No. They got a bunch of people who've decided to get on their face and confess their sin. And God moved. Do you know where revival starts? Well, it starts when we can invite Rock Collins to come down for a one-day meeting. And we're going, no. Revival starts when God's people recognize they got some baggage and they confess it before King Jesus and they repent of it. Oh God, show up. God, if it breaks us, show up, please, Lord. Show up, because when he shows up, it will reveal us for who we are. I see the most beautiful picture of this over there in the Gospel according to Luke in about chapter 2. And the Bible said there were shepherds in the field abiding, watching over their flock by night. And the angel of the Lord appeared in the sky and said, "Fear not." Why is that a beautiful picture of what I'm trying to say? The reason they would have been afraid was not the shock of an angel, but the reason fear would come upon those shepherds is because the angels who had come from the presence of holy, holy, holy God was shining down on sinful man. And that brings fear. Oh God, show up! But when he does, it reveals. When Jesus shows up, there's going to be some questions. When Jesus shows up, there's going to be some baggage that gets unpacked. But I'm going to show you something else. I'm going to be done. All right, here we go. You ready? When Jesus shows up, the truth of who he is will be revealed. I said, when Jesus shows up, the truth of who he is will be revealed. I want you to know, this is one of the most exciting verses of Scripture. Jesus said, "Go get your husband." She said, "I don't have one." He said, "You're right. You've had five and you're shacked up with the one you're with now." And verse 19, "The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive you're a prophet." That's funny. I mean, think about that. Think about it. Woman, you've had five husbands. You shacked up with one. She didn't tell him, but he knew. And she said, "I perceive you're a prophet." Hey, can I tell you something? When Jesus shows up, you'll be sure he's a prophet. Do you know what it means to be a prophet? The prophet knows and speaks the word of God. That's what a prophet does. Listen, when Jesus shows up, he knows and he speaks the word of God. Notice first, he knows. You know how he knows the word of God? Praise be, he is the word. That's what the Bible tells us. But he's also God. He is the mind. He has the mind of God because he is God. You can't separate him. So he knows God because he is God. He knows his word because he is the word. And when he speaks, he will speak the word. And because he is God, he speaks with authority. I perceive you're a prophet. When Jesus shows up, that will be abundantly obvious. When Jesus shows up, you'll say with this woman, he is a prophet. So here she is, and watch the conversation. We're still moving. He's up here on the spiritual level, and she's come to this place where she says, you know, this guy knows something. I'm not sure who he is. He must be a prophet. I think they're getting a little closer. And so she tries again. Watch this. She tries again with her religiosity. She's going to show what she knows. Watch this. Boy, this is something. Watch this. Woman said, sir, I perceive you're a prophet. Verse 20, our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. She said, our forefathers worshipped here, and folk like you say we ought to worship down in Jerusalem. See, she's showing her religiosity. They're getting closer, but she's not on the same level with him yet. She's not in the same conversation yet, but she's getting closer. She's trying again to prop herself up. Notice her baggage has just been revealed, and she's come to the place when he revealed it, she recognized he must be a prophet. So now she's wanting to appear a little more religious. I know where we're supposed to worship. And Jesus looked at it. I'm going to paraphrase the next couple of verses, but this is what he said. He said, woman, those who worship God in spirit and in truth. In other words, he spoke and said, woman, it's not about where you worship, it's who you worship. Come on now. When Jesus shows up, not only will it reveal that he's a prophet, but he'll also reveal that he is the object of our worship. Jesus Christ is the centerpiece for our worship. Well, how do you know we shouldn't worship the Father or the Son? Let me tell you. The Bible said in Philippians 2, God gave him a name that was above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue confess, to the glory of God the Father. When we worship Jesus, we glorify God. He's the object of our worship. And so here's this woman saying, talking about all she knows about worship. And Jesus said, woman, the worship you need to get worried about is not where you worship, but who you worship. When Jesus shows up, there'll be no doubt. When Jesus shows up, there's no doubt about who needs to be worshiped. Amen. That's why I tend to believe what we're hearing about in various hot spots across the country of revival is real, because I don't know anybody's name that's leading it except Jesus. Hello? See, when Jesus shows up, he's the center of worship. The truth will be revealed. He's a prophet. He's the one to worship. But let me show you something else. We get on down here to verse 25. And the woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah is coming. Look at her. She's still showing her religiosity. She not only knew about where to worship, but she knows the Messiah is coming. Boy, this is rich. Watch it. She said, I know Messiah is coming. And I know that when he comes, he will tell us all things. Listen, when Jesus shows up, the truth of the fact that he is a prophet is revealed. The truth that he's the object of worship is revealed. But I want to show you something else. The fact that he is the Messiah is real and evident when he shows up. She said, I know Messiah's coming. He's going to tell us all things. And the next verse, Jesus said, the one you talking to is him. Messiah's not coming. He's here, and he's talking to you. When Jesus shows up, the revelation of who he is abundantly obvious. When Jesus shows up, nobody can compare to him. He said, I am the Messiah. I'm the one that you're talking to. I'm the one that has come. I am. He. And upon this, I'm not through with that point, but I got to show you this verse. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman, yet no man said, "What seekest thou?" or "Why talkest thou with her?" Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus has been talking with this woman for these 20 verses, and her very first question was a cultural question, because she didn't understand how he was going against the cultural norms. She's a lost woman. She don't know him. That's her first question. His disciples have been getting something to eat because they knew he'd be hungry. And when they come back, they do not speak it out loud, but they thought in their heart, according to Scripture, "What's he doing talking to that woman?" Does anybody find this disturbing? I'm not upset that this woman started with a cultural question. But I'm concerned that those who were following Jesus had the same question as a lost woman. Amen. Well, it was their culture. Yeah. And this is a culture that we live in. But God forbid we ever let the culture determine our belief system, amen, our agenda, or our thoughts of people. These were the followers of Jesus. Hey, listen, this is not just some Johnny come lately. They loved Jesus. They were concerned about his physical well-being. That's why they went to get some food. They cared about him. What's he doing talking to a woman? I know I said it once, and I'm going to say it again. God is greater than the culture. It's amazing to me they came back, and that's what they thought. Though they didn't say it, yet it's recorded. You know why? Because it's dangerous to think in the presence of Jesus. I said it's dangerous to think in the presence. See, he knows. You don't even have to say it out loud because he already knows. Amen. And if he knows what you're thinking, please don't fool yourself thinking he doesn't know what's in your baggage. I just wanted you to see this. They're asking the same question. When Jesus shows up, the truth of who he is will be revealed. The fact that he is a prophet. He is the one to worship. He is the Messiah. But look at verse 28. The Bible said, "The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men." Hey, hold on now. Wait a minute. She left her water pot and went to the city. This whole conversation started because she was carrying a water pot down to the well, and Jesus started talking to her about the water that she was wanting to put in that pot. And after 20 verses of discussion, after him being on this spiritual level of conversation, her being here and them getting closer and closer, I want you to know she finally arrived at the right place, because now she said, "I don't even need that water pot. I'm going to leave, because the truth is I found out he is enough. He's sufficient. I don't need the water pot, because now I have the wellspring of life flowing up." That's what happened to her. She said, "I don't need the water pot. Now I got the well." I would to God that some of us would put our water pot down and we just let the well spring up in us. Woo! She found out he is enough. I want to ask you something. Have you found that out yet? When Jesus shows up, he'll reveal he's enough. He will satisfy the very longing of your heart because he and only he can. What is it you're looking for? What is it you're searching for? You'll never find what you're looking for till you find Jesus. I like, as one has said so appropriately, inside of every man and woman, there is a vacuum in the shape of the Lord God himself, and nothing else can fill it but the Lord. God help us to carry the well. But I'm not finished there. When Jesus shows up, the truth is revealed that he's the prophet, that he is the one to be worshipped. He is Messiah. He is enough. But watch this. The Bible said that she left her water pot, went to the city, and saith to the men. Now, wait just a minute. This woman just marched down to town and spoke to the men. That's where this whole conversation started. What are you, a man, doing talking to me, a woman? And now she going to talk to the men. I want to show you a couple things. Number one, here's what she said. Come see a man. Now, come on now. Stay with it. Let's be real. You think those folks in town, the men folk down in town, said, come see a man. Let's see which verse this is. 1, 2, 3. She done had 5. You don't think they thought that? You would have. Here's a woman been married 5 times, shacked up with one. She said, come see a man. Oh, we done heard this song. Huh? But notice not only what she said, but she went to the men. And I know that's where the conversation started, but I want to show you something about this woman. This woman started in this spiritual conversation down here, and now she's getting up here. See, she was lost. And she had been married 5 times and living with a man now. So she wasn't intimidated by a man. I love lost folk get saved. As I heard one guy say, they ain't got no shame to their game. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you see a prostitute come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. They're not intimidated to walk up to a man. They've been doing that in their sinful life. Here's a woman who been running around all kind of men. She ain't afraid to walk up to no man. She walk up to the men in the city, said, come see a man. Oh, they could mock all they wanted. They could say, we've heard this song. They do all that. But she went on and she said, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? When Jesus shows up, the truth will be revealed that he is the prophet. He is the one to be worshipped. He is the Messiah. He is enough. And it'll also be revealed that he and he alone is to be proclaimed. Jesus is to be proclaimed. We are to lift high his name. I know tonight some of you got some questions. Some of you are wondering, even is this woman? I want you to know he can handle your secrets. He can handle your questions. He can handle your business. He knows all about you. And the good news is, once he knows about you, he will not turn you away. He will not tear you down. He will not destroy you. He will not castigate you. He will not demean you. He'll not tell you to go somewhere else. He'll not kick you to the curb. He'll not tell everybody how sorry you are. He'll not alienate you. But I'll tell you what he will do. Praise be to God. He'll love you with an everlasting love. He'll forgive you of all of your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. He'll give you not what you deserve, but he'll give you what you get with grace. Praise be to God. He will hold you close. He'll provide your needs. He'll satisfy the longing of your heart. He'll know your requests before you ask. He'll comfort you. He'll console you. He will put joy in your journey. He'll put a fresh hop in your step. He'll put a new song in your heart. And peace that passes all understanding. When he's done all that, he'll open doors of opportunity for you to give a witness about what happened to you. And I hope to God we'll be like that blind man that Jesus spit in the mud and made him some eyes. He went down to the religious crowd and they said, we want to know what happened. You tell us about this man. Oh, they wanted something to accuse him with. And the old blind man said, look, I don't know all you asking about, but all I know is I was blind and now I see. I was lost, but now I'm found. Can't you just hear this woman at the well? I was thirsty, but now I thirst no more. I've been carrying a water pot, but now I left my water pot because I found what I've been looking for. Jesus is enough. And he is worthy to be proclaimed. I've been hearing this song. I'm losing this mic, so just pray for me. Amen. Amen. I've been hearing this song. I wrote these words down because I wanted you to hear them. It's a song by a lady named Olivia Lane. And some of you probably heard it on the radio. God has just done a miraculous work in her life. And she wrote a song. And I just want to read some of these words because it's so applicable to this text, okay? So just listen. I'm not going to read it all, just a few lines. Listen. She writes, sometimes I feel just like the woman at the well. She could have stopped right there and I could have said, amen. Don't you? Don't you sometimes feel like the woman at the well? She says, sometimes I feel like the woman at the well, wondering how someone could love me when I can't love myself. But you want me as I am, and that sounds crazy. I guess that's why grace is so amazing. Isn't that good? But then she writes this. It's no longer just a story when I read it, because I've seen him for myself, and I believe it. It's okay tonight if you feel like the woman at the well. It's okay if you got some questions. It's okay if your baggage is so very uncomfortable and embarrassing. If you'll just spend a little time with Jesus, you will be unhindered by all those things. And you will want and desire to proclaim Jesus. Somebody sits here tonight lost without Jesus. If you die, you're going to hell because you've never asked Jesus to come into your heart and be Lord of your life. You're just like this woman. You just came, you brought your water pot. I'm just doing what I normally do, just going. But lo and behold, if Jesus didn't show up tonight and his arms are open wide and you see the nail prints in his hands, the nail scars in his feet, the spear-pierced side and the brow that's pierced by the crown of thorns, and he says, I died and shed my blood for you, so that your sins could be forgiven. And I rose from the dead on the third day so you could have life eternal. Would you come into relationship with me? If that's you tonight, he wants to save you. Would you come and meet him? In a moment, our pastor will be here. I'll be here. Come take one of us by the hand and say, I want Jesus. We'd love to introduce you to him. Somebody sits here tonight and you say, Pastor, I'm a Christian. I've accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but I still feel like that woman at the well. Can I help you just a minute? If the devil can help us focus on our baggage and cause us to live in the guilt and disgrace of our baggage, he will paralyze us from being a witness for Jesus. And I just stopped by tonight to say, this woman didn't even get commissioned. Jesus didn't say, now go tell. She just went and told. You know why? Because he forgave her. And when Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just pay for your sin. He paid for your shame. He paid for your guilt. And he's provided grace and mercy in its place. Somebody tonight sits here and you're tired of carrying your baggage and the devil just keeps laying it on you. And I want you to know you don't have to carry that baggage anymore. Come and lay it down at the foot of the cross. And he said, if you confess your sin, I'm faithful to forgive you your sin and will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Somebody could go home free tonight. I don't know what the Lord might have said to you, but if that's you and you're carrying that baggage around and the guilt and the disgrace and the shame of yesterday's failures and sins are haunting you, come lay them at the foot of Jesus. And somebody tonight sits here, and when we got to talking about the woman and all of her baggage, you didn't think about you, but you thought about somebody you know that's carrying a whole lot of baggage. And I just came to exhort you as your brother in Christ, go and tell them to come see a man. And his name is Jesus. And he can forgive them. And if that's the burden of your heart and somebody's on your heart, you need to pray for the altar's open. The invitation's yours. Somebody may say, I've been saved, never followed the Lord in baptism. Boy, we just saw baptism tonight, and I about had to just take a fit. That just blesses my heart, don't it you? If you've never followed the Lord in believer's baptism and you're a believer, that's the first step of obedience. Come make that commitment tonight. I don't know what you need, but King Jesus is here, and he is enough. Father, thank you for meeting with us. Lord God, I know I know you've been in our midst because I felt you here tonight. And God, I thank you. God, I thank you that you did not hesitate to go down there to the well. Because God, that woman needed you. And God, I thank you that you didn't hesitate to come by here. Because you knew we needed you. And God, I don't know who's here that's lost, but Lord, if there's somebody that doesn't know you, save them tonight. Draw them to yourself. Let them say yes to King Jesus. Lord, the other burdens that people are carrying, the shame and the guilt of yesterday, oh God, I pray your sweet hand of forgiveness would cleanse them tonight as they confess it to you. May we leave with a zeal to tell a lost world about you like we've never had before. Lord, this is your invitation. Have your way. Our musicians are going to begin to play. You stand to your feet. As God spoke to your heart, come on. The invitation is open. Now is the time. We'll sing together. You come. You come.
You, Lord, oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From
on,
the moment that I wake
King
up,
Jesus is in the house.
Until I lay
Altar's
my
open.
Head,
come on.
Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah.
All my life you have been faithful.
Yes, he has.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah, sing a little more. Come on.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I want to ask them to continue to play softly. Would you just bow your head in attitude of prayer? There's some at the altar, and there's still room for more, and there's still time. Anybody here tonight, lift your hand and say, "Preacher, I'm lost without Jesus. Would you pray for me? I'm lost." Anybody say, "I'm lost"? Just slip up your hand and say, "I'm lost without Jesus. Would you pray for me?" Is there anybody? "I'm lost. If I die, I'm going to hell. Would you pray for me?" Is there anybody? Anybody here tonight say, "Brother Rock, I know that I'm saved, but I got some baggage that's really eating me up, and I didn't even feel comfortable walking the aisle, but would you pray for me?" Now, I'm not going to come to you, but I'll pray for you right here. I won't embarrass you, but I'll pray for you. Is there anybody? Say, "Preacher, I just got some baggage, and I need some help. Would you pray for me?" Just slip up your hand. I'd be glad to pray for you. God bless you. God bless you. Somebody else, pray for me, "Preacher, I just got some baggage." God, you saw those hands. You know the baggage they carry. Lord, you know how the enemy has used it in their lives. God, I pray in the name of Jesus, by the power of his shed blood, that you'd rebuke the enemy. That, Lord, you'd give them freedom from those things of yesterday that are gone and plunged beneath the blood of the Lamb. And God, I pray they'd find sweet victory tonight. Lord, I pray they'd find a shout this evening because you set them free, forgiven them of their sin, and delivered them from that which has them bound. Oh God, thank you that you are the deliverer and the forgiver and the giver of grace. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing that stanza one more time. All my life, you've been faithful.
All my life, you have been faithful. And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.